Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Bethesda Lutheran Church in Carlton. This is the 18th Sunday after Pentecost, and Pastor Jim is not with us today, but he will be here on the next two Sundays. And then?
Just one Sunday. Just next Sunday.
Well, I thought he was there on the 18th also. Well, he'll be here next Sunday. And then tune in the following Sunday and see what happens. Always nice to have a little mystery in our lives, isn't it? And some suspense. So, there you go. If you could fill out the pew pads, that would be helpful to us so we know who is here today. And they're not there. Well, good luck with that. If you don't, okay. So, peanut butter, we're going to try to keep collecting some peanut butter. That was kind of our item in September for the food shelf, and it's really a good item, and it's easy to transport, so we will be doing that through October also. Does anybody have any announcements? Debbie? Do you want to come up and use the mic?
No, I'll stand back here.
Okay.
For God Works Our Hands, we continually work on baby kits throughout the year. The item we're short on is receiving blankets and flannel sheets. We have people that cut the flannel sheets down to the right size. So for anyone who has receiving blankets, flannel sheets, they can call the office or let me know, and I can pick them up and you can bring them to the church.
Okay. Debbie is saying that this is about a way of continuing God's work on our hands. And right now, the project that they're working on, they really need receiving blankets and flannel that can be made into receiving blankets. If you have those items, you can bring them to the church and Debbie to pick them up here. Or you could call the church and let them know that you have them, and Bobby will get a hold of Debbie. So,
that's flannel sheets.
And also flannel sheets.
Okay.
Thank you, Debbie. Okay, I think that's anybody else with announcements? Oh, yes, and then.
You're right. He is here the next two Sundays.
Okay, well, I'm a big now. He will be here the next two Sundays. Pastor Jim will be here the next two Sundays. But once again, tune in to see, because you never know. You know, it's one way you can keep you coming back. Let's see what they're doing this Sunday. So, and Christy, yeah, you know, when I'm up here, you never know what's going to happen. Christy's over on the side giggling at me because she knows it can be quite exciting, unusual at times. We do try to prepare for this service. There's actually a lot of preparation goes into this. And Christy really knows what should be happening here. And sometimes it happens, so. Okay, let's start with our opening prayer today. Beloved God, from you came all things that are good. Lead us by the inspiration of your Spirit to know those things that are right. And by your merciful guidance, help us to do them through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen. And now we're going to have our opening hymn, which is Lead Me, Guide Me, and it's 7, 6, 8.
Thank you.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who creates, redeems, and sustains us and all creation.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Faithful God,
have mercy on us. We confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We turn from your loving embrace and go on our ways. We pass judgment on one another before examining ourselves. We place our own needs before those of our neighbors. We keep your gift of salvation to ourselves.
Make us humble,
cast away our transgressions, and turn us again to life in you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
God hears the cries of all who call out in need, and through his death and resurrection, Christ has made us his own. Hear the truth that God proclaims. Your sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Led by the Holy Spirit, live in freedom and newness to God's work in the world. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Beloved God, from you come all things that are good. Lead us by the inspiration of your Spirit to know those things that are right, and by your merciful guidance, help us to do them. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. We'll now have the first reading.
Which no longer have any bearing in comparison to the right relationship we have been given through the death of Christ. The power of Christ's resurrection motivates him to press on toward the ultimate goal, eternal life in Christ. Paul writes, "If anyone else has reason to be confident in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, a member of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. Yet whatever gains I had, these I have come to regard as loss because of Christ. More than that, I regard everything as loss because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus as my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things, and I regard them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in them, and not have a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one that comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God based on faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the sharing of his sufferings by becoming like him in death, if somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained this or have already reached the goal, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus had made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead. I press on toward the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm is Psalm 80, verses 7 through 15. We'll read them responsively. Look down from heaven, O God. Behold and tend this vine. Restore us, O God of hosts. Let your face shine upon us, and we shall be saved.
You have brought a vine out of Egypt. You cast out the nations and planted it.
You cleared the ground for it. It took root and filled the land.
The mountains were covered by its shadow, and the towering cedar trees by its boughs.
You stretched out its tendrils to the sea and its branches to the river.
Why have you broken down its walls so that all who pass by pluck off its grapes?
The wild boar of the forest
Turn now, O God of hosts, look down from heaven.
Behold and tend this vine, preserve what your right hand has planted. The Gospel reading for today. Jesus said to the people, listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, but put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went to another country. When the harvest time had come, he sent his slaves to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenants seized his slaves and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other slaves, more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, they will respect my son. But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance. So they seized him, threw him on the ground, and killed him. Now when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? They said to him, he will put those wretches to a miserable death, and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at harvest time. Jesus said to them, have you ever read in the scriptures, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone? This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes. Therefore I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruits of the kingdom. The one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and it will crush anyone on whom it falls. When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they realized he was speaking about them. They wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowds because they regarded him as a prophet. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. extend human peace from God our Father. One of the small luxuries that used to be available in most hotels was the personal makeup call. Remember that? Hotel clerk would ask you when you checked in, would you like a makeup call? Most of you would not have time for that service. Next morning, you might not have time to get a call from a real-life Christian who woke you up with the words, "Good morning, Mr. Eisen. This is your wake-up call." And then you decide whether to go back to sleep or not. That task, like everything else, is now assigned to computers. More hotels offer a personal makeup call. These days, many people use their cell phones as their phone calls. And yet, we have wake-up calls and self-dating. But there are a few high-end hotels that still advertise a personal makeup call that's guaranteed to get you out of bed. One luxury hotel in Aruba makes an initial wake-up call and sends an employee to knock on your door a few minutes later to ensure you actually wake up. It's like a huge snooze button. Another hotel sends a butler with coffee and evening pastries. It's not on your door. The idea would definitely be that we are. Another hotel, if you missed the wake-up call three times, the hotel manager will send you a security guard to knock loudly on your door. No chance you should do that kind of wake-up call. But today I'm thinking about wake-up calls. What does it take to get you fully awake and ready for a new day? Are you one of those people who wake up and easily jump out of bed? Or are you one of those people who need to be shaken awake and picked out of bed before you start the morning? The second description sounds more like you. And you relate to today's lesson to the scriptures. It was written by Paul. Man who needed to be shaken awake and kicked out of bed. He didn't need to be awakened from deep sleep. He needed to be awakened from a way of life that was leading him far away from God and closer to death and destruction. Ironically, it's a way of life that looked on the outside like success. Paul, whose Hebrew name was Saul, was an Israelite, descendant of Abraham from the tribe of Benjamin. He had a respected family heritage. He was a student of the law of Israel. He studied under Gamaliel, a respected Pharisee. Paul was educated, influential, respected. By all measures in his society, he was a success. And a single goal in life, to protect the Hebrew law. We need to know, first of all, as we think of this lesson, that successful people usually have worthwhile goals. If you want to honor God with your life, you want to make sure that you don't waste the precious gifts God has given you. And the best thing you can do is create some worthwhile goals for yourself. Goal setting comes from the belief that your life has a purpose. If your life were random and meaningless, then setting goals wouldn't make sense. But if your life has purpose, if you have the opportunity to make an impact in your sphere of influence, and setting worthwhile goals is the best way to do it. Worthwhile goals require vision, planning, discipline, sacrifice. Successful people have a vision for where they want to go and who they want to be. They create a plan to get them there. Let me introduce you to a young man who learned the value of setting goals. Chad Williams was partying his way to the community college when he experienced his own personal wake-up call. He realized that his life was going nowhere. He decided to cut both first acts. He chose the toughest goal he could think of. He decided to join the Navy SEALs. You probably know that Navy SEALs are an elite special operations force. Their training is so rigorous and the missions are so demanding. Only a tiny number of people who apply for SEAL training ever completed. Chad's father put him in touch with an active Navy SEAL. In 2004, before Chad entered the SEAL training program, Scott, his mentor, was captured in Fallujah, Iraq. He and the other SEALs were murdered. Bodies were hung from the bridge over the Euphrates River. The fate was broadcast by television and news stations around the world. Chad's goal in life suffering dramatically changed. Chad was now focused on becoming the best Navy SEAL possible to honor his mentor, Scott Henderson. Timothy, served in missions all over the world and achieved a goal few people could even dream of. Fortunately, Chad still felt empty, restless. He had invested all his energy, skills, and time in this goal, only to find that it wasn't what he truly yearned for in life. Think about that for a moment. He turned to the stroke of the ball. One time, Paul saw his own worthwhile goals. He describes himself as being zealous for God. Zealous is in the word you mentioned, where he's enthusiastic or passionate for the cross. Paul wanted to honor God in his religious heritage as a member of the tribe of Benjamin. He demonstrated his commitment to his goal by carefully studying the law, by persecuting those Jews who didn't strictly obey the law, particularly this new sect of Jews who followed a dead rabbi named Jesus. That his goal, which he was totally committed to, led him to go house to house in Jerusalem, hunting down followers of Jesus, dragging them off to jail. He even participated in an act of mock violence when a crowd of equally zealous Jews stoned to death a young preacher named Stephen, the first Christian martyr listed in the scriptures. By his own standards, Paul was very successful in achieving his goals. What does it mean if you're very successful at achieving the wrong goals? Some of you may have heard me mention the name John Krakauer before. John is a mountain climber who has written a number of books on his climbing adventures. In his book, Into Thin Air, he writes of the day in May 1996, when he finally reached the summit of Mount Everest. A number of his fellow climbers had died along the route. Krakauer wrote, "I understand on some dim, detached level that it was a spectacular sight. I've been fantasizing about this moment and the release of emotion that would accompany it for many months. But now that I was finally here, standing on the summit of Mount Everest, I just couldn't summon the energy to care." It's interesting. What do you do when you finally arrive and the thrill that you thought you'd get from pursuing your goal is not all that great? What do you do? Sometimes our goals and our definition of success need to be pried out of our hands before we wake up to what you're rooting for. Many of you know what it's like to have a wake-up call like that. You're consumed with thoughts about promotion at work and didn't get the call. Your child's in the emergency room. Right, or it's sort of not real quick at a time like that. I think that Paul bought on the road to Damascus to arrest more followers of Jesus. Paul, who was going by his Hebrew name Saul at that time, was struck blind by a flash of light from heaven. And he heard the voice of Jesus asking him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" Saul spent 3 days in Damascus, helpless, blind, questioning the direction of his life. Spend time questioning the direction of your life? How can we be sure that the goals we're pursuing, the goals we're giving our time and strength and energy and life to, are truly worthwhile? What happens if we achieve our goals, discover that we spent our lives in a pursuit that was not God's highest choice for us? What do we have to lose to discover that God really made us? How they crashed under the Damascus Road. After 3 days of blindness, Paul was healed through the intervention of a follower of Jesus named Ananias. At that moment, Paul's previous goals for his life began to look a lot like garbage. That's how he described his previous life goals in today's lesson. He says, "But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What's more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage." Later in the same passage, he says, "I want to know Christ, yes, to know the powers of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead." And still later, he sums up his new goal. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. While Paul had only one goal, and that was to serve Jesus Christ. Wouldn't it be great to have only one goal in life? One goal that you know in your bones was the purpose God made you for? This is it. You are made to serve Jesus Christ. You were made to live out Jesus' values and priorities. You were made to do good works that express the love and hope of Jesus Christ in the world. And if God made you for that purpose, then it's only in serving Jesus Christ that you'll find your identity and peace and joy and fulfillment. No other goal will satisfy your life in the same way. And that brings us back to the story of Chad Williams, our Navy SEAL, who thought he would find success in a military career with one of the most elite special forces teams in the world. One evening, Chad and his girlfriend were invited to attend a worship service. Speaker Greg Laurie preached on a passage from the Old Testament about Naaman, commander of the Syrian army who contracted leprosy. You might remember that story. In order for God to heal him, the prophet Elisha told Naaman he had to remove all his armor, bathed himself in the Jordan River. Lowry made the point that Naaman had to humble himself, give up his symbols of strength and protection, and submit to God's plan before he could be healed. Something in the story of Naaman spoke to Chad Williams' deepest needs that night. He gave his life to Jesus. Today, Chad Williams is a best-selling author and speaker who shares his faith in Jesus all over the nation. In his estimation, being a Navy SEAL is great, but being a disciple of Jesus Christ is a far greater significance. Bottom line, if you want to move forward in life, if you want to accomplish something significant in life, then you have to set worthwhile goals for yourself. That's what successful people do. But if you want to honor God, you want to make a positive impact for God, an impact that lives on after you're gone, then you need to have only one goal in life, serving Jesus Christ. Doesn't mean you need to be a missionary in a foreign country or a Christian worker in the inner city. It does mean that you'll seek to be the person God needs for you to be wherever you end up. It's what you were made for. It's where you will find your identity and purpose and peace. It's the one thing that will make the most difference in the world in your life. Something to think about this day. Amen. May God's peace and love be with you now and forever. Amen.
I have it on the authority of our technical person that we're going to hopefully clean that up. We did not realize that it had that much interference from someplace. So that mysterious interference will hopefully be found and removed. So you can pray on that this coming week. Let us join together now in the creed. Oh, I thought you were doing it now, but not later.
No.
Oh, okay. That's one of the things. I will move on then to the prayers of intercession. See, I told you, Christine, no one else is supposed to go, so you just have to rely on her. So we will do the prayers of intercession. Lord, with confidence in God's grace and mercy, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. Holy God, you call us to work for peace and justice in your vineyard. Refresh the church with your light, that we may bear fruit through work and service. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Thank you for the abundant harvest of the earth. Bless and care for those whose hands bring the fruits of the earth to the tables of all who hunger. May we be inspired by your service, who care deeply for your creation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Curb the impulses of greed and pride that lead us to take advantage of others. Grant that world leaders seek the fruits of the kingdom for the good and welfare of all people. Lord, in your mercy,
Hear our prayer.
Sustain all who suffer with the promise of new life. Assured of your presence, heal our pain and suffering, and equip us to embrace all bodies aching for wholeness of mind, body, and soul. We call to mind those who are struggling today. And at this point, if you have people that you would like brought up for prayer, or just pray for them silently. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all managers in our community and for all who seek employment. Give hope and a future to those who lack meaningful work, those who have been marginalized or abused in the workplace, and those who desire new opportunities. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Thank you for the saints who teach us to live faithfully in our vineyard. May our chorus join theirs until our labor is complete. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Listen as we call on you, O God, and enfold in your loving arms all for whom we pray. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Now we are going to have communion today. That you received when you came in. We were blessed last Sunday when Pastor Jim was here. And the actual words that we are going to be using for communion are the ones that on our visitation team here in church, we use these when we go into like the home of someone or at, when we used to do service at Interfaith. And so this is what we're using now, which is a little different than what you normally hear. Peace to you from our Lord Jesus Christ. When we gather for the celebration of Holy Communion, we hear again the story of God's mighty acts and the love shown us in the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. With thanksgiving, we remember that in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." We are given assurance of our Lord's presence through the gift of his Holy Spirit. Now we share in the same bread of life and the same cup a blessing, that you may be strengthened through your participation in the body of Christ. As we prepare for this great gift, let us confess our sins and hear the promise of forgiveness. We confess that we have bodily sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not lived with our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. Now, when we do the elements, the very top layer of plastic comes off and the wafer is right underneath that. And then there's another layer of craft plastic, and that's where the grape juice is at. So as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So the body of Christ given for you. Amen. And the blood of Christ shed for you. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of the gift of life. We pray that in your mercy, you would strengthen us through this gift, in faith toward you, and in fervent love toward one another, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. Would you stand for the Lord's Prayer, please? Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father,
who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive
those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom,
and the power,
and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, gracious God, that you have once again fed us with food beyond compare, the body and the blood of Christ. Lead us from this place, nourished and forgiven, into your beloved vineyard. To wipe away the tears of all who hunger and thirst, guided by the example of the Saint Jesus Christ, and led by the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. So may the Lord be with you as you leave this place today. May you feel his blessings. May you feel his strength and his guiding hand. May you think on the words of the sermon that we do have a purpose to be here on this earth, and that God will give you guidance and strength to carry out that mission toward that goal. So may you feel that this has been a word that you could, like your wake-up call. I think that was the cool thing there. Whatever your wake-up call might be, I hope this was part of it, and that you can leave this gathering today and go out and remember that in your daily life. We will now end with